वक्रतुंड महाकाया सूर्यकोटिसमप्रभा निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देवा सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा। श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः। नमस्ते फ्रेंड्स, वी आर जॉइंड ऑन ए वेरी स्पेशल डे ऑन विच टू ऑफ अवर ग्रेट लीडर्स वर बॉर्न। वी आर सेलिब्रेटिंग द जयंती ऑफ महात्मा गांधी एंड लाल बहादुर शास्त्री, वर ग्रेट फॉलोअर्स ऑफ भगवद्गीता इन लेटर एंड स्पिरिट। Gita gave them the strength to achieve what they achieved. Let's remember these two great souls and continue our study. Welcome you to the 10th session of Bhagavad Gita class. We are today discussing the 9th chapter called Rajavidya Rajaguhya Yoga. After discussing Saguna Brahma or Apara Prakriti, which leads to Krama Mukti in 8th chapter, we are back to Nirguna Brahma or Para Prakriti in this chapter, which takes us to Sadhyo Mukti or Jivan Mukti. This is very similar to 7th chapter. Since this is king of knowledge, it is called Rajavidya. And since it will remain a secret to unprepared minds, it is called Rajaguhya. Hence, Rajavidya, Rajaguhya Yoga. The subject matter of this chapter is Nirguna Ishvara Brahma. Dr. Hegde sir and his team of teachers will unravel the secrets of this chapter. At the end of the class, Srimati Shyamala and Srimati Meenakshi are going to chant shlokas 1 to 20 of this chapter. Let's have our Gita books with us and follow them. Now, let's listen to Dr. Ravi Shankar, who will do a quick recap of previous chapter. Ravi sir.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. In the Madhyama Shatkam of the Gita, chapter 7 to 12, the sadhana is upasana, that is saguna brahma vishaya manasa vyapara. As a sakama upasada, it results in iha, paraloka, materialistic gains, siddhi as byproduct, but is completely devoid of spirituality. As a nishkama upasana with jnana yoga abhyasa through sadhana chatushtaya, one withdraws from nishkama upasana, enters into Vedanta vichara. Now, nirguna ishvara is the aim. With shravana manana nididhyasana under an able guru, one gains nirguna brahma jnana nishtha. And this leads to Jivan Mukti or Sadhyo Mukti, also called as Akrama Mukti. Here and now, based on the Prarabdha, he continues to live in the body like anyone else. Now there is a shift. Ishvara Upasana, when done without materialistic needs as a Nishkama Upasana and with a keenness for Mukti. But this person does not have Jnana Yoga, doesn't have Vedanta Vichara, does not even feel qualified that he has it, and doesn't have a guru. They continue to have Ishvara Saguna Chintana. We know that what we remember at the time of death decides the next Janma. And when such a person dies, he gets a different route, and that's called as Shuklagati. And he attains Brahmaloka. Under the tutelage of Brahmaji himself, he gains the knowledge of Nirguna Ishvara Upasana, attains Mukti, and that is called as Krama Mukti. This is the essence of the chapter 8 called Akshara Brahma Yoga. Sri Krishna mentions in the third verse, Aksharam Param Brahma. And that's how this word Akshara comes. Akshara does not mean an alphabet, but it refers to the supreme, indestructible, and it also means Om. In the 7th chapter, Lord Krishna on his own explains his glory and virtues, and he mentions that knowing the following: Brahman, Adhyatma, Adibhuta, Adidaiva, Adiyajna, Karma, and taking refuge in me with a steadfast mind at the time of death knows me. This forms the basis of doubts raised by Arjuna, and hence Bhagavan Krishna answers them. What are these? What is Adhyatma? Adhyatma is the conscious principle at the micro level. Brahman is the conscious principle at the macro level. Adibhutam is the material universe made up of the Panchabhutas. Adidaiva is the Hiranyagarbha, that is the conscious principle, consciousness principle with the total mind of all beings. Adiyajna is the Ishvara Tattvam, that is higher than Hiranyagarbha and the karma phala data in the jivas. What is the location of all these? It's in the body. What is karma? That which is responsible for the creation, based on punya and papa. The next question is Prayana Kale Ishwara Smaran is explained by the Bhagwan Das. Vasanas formed over time takes over the weak willpower in old age. Shubha Mangala Vasanas at the time of death, either as form or alamba or as a symbol like Om, when used as a Nishkama Upasana, leads to Krama Mukti. Now, human goals could be materialistic, bound by time and space, and they are ephemeral. They cannot give rise to lasting peace, happiness, and security, and hence they are completely finite. But human goals, which are God-related and spiritual and infinite, lead to Shreyas or Moksha. There are two paths that one can choose. Those with the finite goals, after following the ritualistic life, social service, Panchamaha Yajnas, can reach higher lokas, but not the Brahma loka. They enjoy higher peace and higher happiness, but they remain an Ajnani Karmi. They have Punarapi Jananam, Punarapi Mananam, and they remain in samsara. The others who take up Nirguna Upasana, they become a Ajnani Upasaka and attain Shuklagati. This chapter contrasts an Ajnani Karmi and an Ajnani Upasaka. There is no mention of the subject of Jnanam. Lord Krishna extols Arjuna to take up Nirguna Upasana, as it is lesser than Jnanam, but much, much better than being just a Karmi. Hari Om, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi Shankar, for a nice summary of the chapter 8, Akshara Brahma Yoga. Tvameva mata cha pita tvameva, tvameva bandhuscha sakha tvameva, tvameva vidya dravinam tvameva, tvameva sarvam mama deva deva. We begin the study of the 9th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita titled Raja Vidya Raja Guhya Yoga. This chapter is very similar to the 7th chapter, and both these work for Jivan Mukti or Sadhyo Mukti. Verses 4 to 10 in this chapter are the essence of the Upanishads and are particularly difficult to understand and have certain very cryptic mantras also. In this chapter also there is an understanding as to why we are in samsara, what is the cause of all our suffering. And the answer comes is our ignorance of the higher form of God. And because we do not know God in his higher form, we invest on the lower form that we see and experience, which is the apara prakriti. The solution for the problem of samsara is bhakti. And this is one of the most beautiful chapters devoted to bhakti, although Krishna has a separate chapter, 12th chapter, titled Bhakti Yoga. Before we go into a deeper understanding of this particular chapter, I thought I would like to introduce something about the Upanishads. The Upanishads are also called Vedanta. Vedanta means the end portion or the philosophical portion of the Vedas. Krishna has milked the essence of all the Upanishads and presented it into the Bhagavad Gita. In different chapters in stray pockets, for instance, in this chapter between 4 and 10, verses deal entirely with the Upanishadic wisdom. Normally, the Bhagavad Gita is very popular, but very few people venture into the world of the Upanishads. Osho has said, never before or never after has human consciousness attained to such Himalayan heights. The days of the Upanishads are truly golden. The Upanishads are a little higher level, a little postgraduate level compared to the Bhagavad Gita. But once we look into one or two Upanishads, we have a deeper understanding of our true nature, which is also the true nature of Bhagwan. And therefore, a glimpse of the Upanishads will help us to understand the Bhagavad Gita. Krishna begins the 7th chapter in a most wonderful way. He says, I will give you jnanam and vijnanam. I'll give you knowledge and wisdom. This I will impart to you so thoroughly. And if you have this knowledge, there is nothing more worth knowing. To again understand what Krishna is trying to say, we will see how the Upanishads teach us. The Upanishads tell us that we have to move from what appears to be real to that which is real. The Upanishadic verse from the Brihadaranyaka Upanishad goes like this, Asato ma sadgamaya. Very strange and very difficult to believe. The Upanishads say, whatever I see and experience and whatever I can very tangibly feel are not as real as I think it is. For example, we see the sunset and the sunrise. My eyes can clearly see the sun setting or the sun rising, but from scientific knowledge, we know that what I'm seeing is not true and the reality is just the other way. So too, the Upanishads make a very daring statement to say, the reality is someone other than what I experience. The one who is experiencing all that is the real, and that is what we study in the Upanishads. The Upanishads therefore tell us how to overcome suffering is to shift from the experienced world to the experiencer. The experienced world is called mithya. The experiencer, the consciousness principle in all of us, is called satya. The style of the Upanishads is totally different, and they invest a lot on our understanding of dreams. There is a story related to King Janaka. King Janaka was also referred to in the third chapter of the Bhagavad Gita as an example of a person who could be a grihastha, who could be an emperor, who could be part of the family and yet be a jnani and get all spiritual wisdom. And the story goes that King Janaka had a terrible dream. In that dream, he was a beggar. And as a beggar, he suffered intense poverty, intense hunger, intense humiliation. And when he woke up, he was contrasted with the luxury of the king in a palace. And being a wise man that he was, a certain doubt arose in him. This kind of doubt does not come. We too dream and we dismiss our dream as a dream. But King Janaka had a very pertinent question. And the question that he had was, did I, King Janaka, have a dream that I was a beggar? Or did a beggar have a dream that he is King Janaka? Which is true? Ye sat hai, ya wo sat hai? And this became such a deep question to him that none of his duties could be performed. And the news spread in the kingdom that king has gone mad because he has only one question. Ye sat hai, ya wo sat hai? Fortunately, at that time, there was an enlightened master called Ashtavakra. The word Ashta means eight, Vakra means deformities. Ashtavakra comes to King Janaka and answers his question. And he says, Dono asat hai. Both are unreal. If both are unreal, then what is real? That was revealed to him through the Ashtavakra Gita. And through the Upanishads, we move from what appears to be real, from the mithya world to the satya world. The Upanishads say there are three levels of reality. When I go through the dream world, my experiences in the dream are absolutely real. I can say it is a dream only when I wake up. That reality that I experience in the dream is called a reflected reality or a pratibhasika satya. That is also satya, but at a different level. That is a lower level of a reality compared to what I experience all around me. This looks really real for me. But our teachers say this is a higher order compared to the dream, and this is called vyavaharika satya. Those who are awoken to a higher level of consciousness, which is called the paramarthika satya, they say that this is just like waking up from a dream, and all our effort of the Gita and the Upanishads is helping us to wake up to our higher self, wake up to this spiritual knowledge that the real me is the one that is conscious, the one that is experiencing everything around. My body and mind is of a lower order of reality. And unless this becomes a nishta, unless this we are convinced about this, we will continue to suffer because we invest in our body, invest in our mind. And when our body mind becomes real, the world around me, my family, my property, my investment, my job, my name and fame, all become real. So the first shift in Asato Ma Sadgamaya is to move from my body to the embodied. Second is the analysis of a prakriya called, we don't live in one world, we live in three worlds. The three worlds are the dream world, this waking world. Now, when I am in dream, the experience of my dream is absolutely real. When I wake up, I remember my dream. That means there is someone who has remembered my experiences in my dream. I, the waker, was not there, but there is a third entity who was there, who has experienced my dream. And when I wake up, it helps me to recollect my dream. The third experience that all of us go are waking, dream, and deep sleep. When I'm fast asleep, when we are all asleep, we don't know anything. But one thing we are absolutely certain of is that I have slept well. Who is there within us who is aware of the fact that I slept well? In fact, I may not know anything, but I'm so certain that I have slept well. And of course, there is the Sakshi principle, who knows that I am awake. So there is a witness of my waking experiences. There is a witness of my dream experiences. There is a witness of my deep sleep experiences. So that is apart from all the three. So that one constant factor we need to meditate on, that is what they call as Brahman or the Atman within all of us. One more prakriya or one more technique used by the Upanishads. They say, look at yourself when you are very young, when you are a little child. If you can look at your own photograph when you are small, and you will see from now till then, over the years, how much your body has changed. They say every 7 years, our body undergoes almost a complete change. Our bodies have changed, our minds have changed, our thoughts have changed, our interests have changed. But one thing has never changed. I, who has lived in and through all these bodies, I am the same. I am the same in that childhood photograph. I am the same one even now, which means there is one common factor in and through these tremendous body-mind experience. The Upanishads make us inquire, who is that? Bhagwan Ramana Maharshi is known for a very famous quote that he gave a small child who was seriously ill to meditate on. And this helped the child and the parents. And the Upanishadic wisdom to meditate on is Deham Naham. I am not this body. And when a great master tells you with all conviction, I'm not this body, the next process that I have to go through is Koham. Inquire using a guru and scriptures to find out, if I am not my body, then who am I? And then through various prakriyas, through various techniques, it is called through Shruti, Yukti, Anubhuti. Through scriptural text, through my own experiences, and through logic, I come to discover that I am not just somebody ordinary, I am extraordinary. I am the divine principle, and for want of any word, we will use the word Sakshi or consciousness. That consciousness is that principle which is enlivening this body, and because of that principle, I'm able to experience the whole world. Swami Paramarthananda has given a brilliant analysis of what is this consciousness. And going on the same theme, Swamiji very clearly says, this consciousness is not part of my body. It is not a property of my body. It is not a product of my body. It is an independent entity which pervades every part of the body and makes my body enlivened, makes my body alive. Just like, if you can see my hand, in addition to my hand, there is something else because of which you're able to see my hand. And that is the light that is upon my hand. Because you're able to see the light on my hand, and you will know that the light on my hand is not part of my hand, it's not a property of my hand, it is not a product of my hand, it is an independent entity which pervades my hand and makes my hand visible. If I take off my hand, the light continues to exist, but because of a want of a reflecting media, I'm not able to perceive the presence of light. So too, my consciousness is not limited to my body. It is an infinite, all-pervading, common principle. The consciousness survives even after the fall of the body, and the surviving consciousness cannot be perceived for want of a reflecting media. If this is understood, these cryptic verses from 4 to 10 will be understood. both Dr. Rupa and I, I'm not going to make an attempt to explain the details of these verses because they take some time, but you will get a proper idea if these things are very true. There are some 7, 8, or 10 principles about this consciousness or Atma or the Brahman within me. I am of the nature of consciousness. My real me is Satya. Everything else is of a lower order of reality, including my body mind. The real me is Nirguna. That means it has no attributes. And if it has no attributes in three things, no attributes in time. If there is no attributes in time, the real me is there from the very beginning. If there is a beginning, it will be there till the very end. It is Nitya. It is beyond time. The real me is not limited to my body. It is all pervading. And because it is all pervading, it is an infinite principle. It is all inclusive. The real me does not have any properties whatsoever, and that is why my sense organs are not able to experience it. That is why it is called unmanifest or avyakta. And because it is infinite, it is all inclusive. There cannot be a second conscious principle. This is being of a higher order of reality. It cannot be affected by my body, mind, or any experiences, and that is why it is called asanga. Because again, it is infinite. To do anything, some movement is required. That is why it cannot do anything. It is akarta. Because it does not do anything, it does not experience anything, it is abhokta. And it is this consciousness which is the adhara, which is the support of the whole mithya world. These things, if understood, the rest of the Upanishad or the Bhagavad Gita become more clearer. Vinayakan will explain to us the opening verse. Vinayakan, please.
Hari Om Sri Gurubhyo Nama. Raja Vidya Raja Guhyam Pavitramidam Uttamam Pratyakshavagamam Dharmyam Susukham Kartum Avyayam. This is the greatest knowledge, the greatest secret, the most sacred, directly attainable, unopposed to Dharma, very easy to pursue and imperishable. Ishwara Jnana Mahima is the topic explained here. Rajavidya, this knowledge, that is Ishvara Jnanam, is the royal knowledge. It is the greatest knowledge among all the disciplines of knowledge. This knowledge explained in Mundaka Upanishad as Paravidya. This Ishvara Jnanam deals with the highest Satyam or reality or Nirguna Swarupa. Other disciplines of knowledge deals with the unreal or Mithya Swarupa, that is Aparavidya as per Mundaka Upanishad. Therefore, this knowledge, that is Ishvara Jnanam, is the glorious knowledge. This is the only liberating knowledge. Intellectual dissatisfaction is the sense of limitation of all the other knowledge. Same time, this knowledge is Raja Guhyam. It is the greatest secret also, not easily available for most of the people, and it is the greatest wonder. This knowledge is Pavitram. This Ishvara Jnanam is the greatest purifier in the creation, which removes all the impurities in the form of karmas like Sanjita, Agami, Punya Papa Karma, etc. and purifies other impurities like Kama, Krodha, Moha, Lobha, Mahatmada, Matsarya, etc. and it destroys the greatest impurity, that is Ajnanam, ignorance. In 4th chapter, Lord Krishna says, Nahi Jnanena Sadrisham Pavitramiha Vidyate. It is not ordinary purifier. It is Uttama Pavitram, the perfect purifier. And another main feature is Pratyakshavagamam. It is directly available here and now. The benefit can be expressed here and now. Manashanti can be experienced here and now. Then Dharmyam. It is in keeping with Vedic teaching. In our tradition, we consider Veda as the basic source of knowledge. And therefore, always any system of teaching which is in keeping with the Vedic teaching is acceptable in our tradition. Next is Susukham Kartum. Gaining this knowledge and Jivan Mukti is far easier. Susukham means very comfortable. One can get Nirguna Ishvara Jnanam and Jivan Mukti more comfortably than Krama Mukti. Compared to Krama Mukti, Jivan Mukti is far easier. In the 8th chapter, Lord Krishna talks about the Krama Mukti. In that, you have to do Upasana throughout. Then after death, you will reach to Brahmaloka. From there, Lord Brahmaji will teach you and lead you to liberation. But in Jivan Mukti, gain the knowledge and get liberated. then finally avyayam. This knowledge is imperishable in terms of its result. Paladrishtva avyayam, which means one will get the benefit of moksha, which is permanent benefit. Kartum sukshmam avyayam. Lord Krishna says, such a wonderful Ishvara Jnanam, Arjuna, I am going to impart to you. So Lord Krishna, after giving a lot of introduction, slowly takes us to the royal secret knowledge. That is Raja Vidya, Raja Gukhya Yoga. Hari Om. Thank you.
Thank you, Vinayakan. Vinayakan works in Narendradalian, the clinical pharmacology department, an ardent student of Vedanta, also pursuing a course on medical law and ethics at the National Law University. This is how Shri Krishna begins this chapter. Krishna is a great advertiser. He says, I'm going to give you the royal knowledge. And he also tell you it is going to be a royal secret. And if you get this knowledge, moksha says shubhat, you will easily get freedom from samsara. Vinayakan has explained all the words, but I would like to focus on one word, susukam. Susukam, Swamiji quotes this words to say whenever you want to say Brahma Vidya is easy, this quotation comes. Normally we think Brahma Vidya is very difficult to pursue, but this verse Krishna says susukam. Susukam means easy for one who is a prepared student. And that's why if there is a proper preparation, this knowledge becomes very easy. Krishna also tries to increase your interest by telling you it's a great secret. I'm going to tell you a great secret. It is said something which is very sacred is also usually kept as a secret so that you have a greater reverence to it, and it is given to those who really want it. So that is one of the significance of this Guhyatamam. This comes two more times in the same Bhagavad Gita. It comes in the 15th chapter. In the 15th chapter, when Krishna is concluding this Iti Guhyatamam Shastram, this is the last word of the 15th chapter, where Krishna tells Arjuna, I have given you the greatest secret. And again, in the 18th chapter, when Krishna is concluding, there again, he tells you, I have given you the greatest of the greatest secrets. So it is very exciting to know what is the great secret that Shri Krishna is going to reveal. Dr. Rupa, we have heard Dr. Rupa before. Dr. Rupa is going to explain to us some of the most cryptic verses in this section of the Bhagavad Gita. Dr. Rupa, please.
Om Shri Guru Pyo Namaha. मया ततमिदं सर्वं जगदव्यक्तमूर्तिना मस्तानि सर्वभूतानि न चाहं तेष्वस्थितः. In this verse and from the verses 9 to 4 of this chapter, basically we are going to learn about the essence or the saram of the Upanishads. The English translation of this verse goes like this. All this universe is pervaded by me, whose form is unmanifest. All beings are in me, still I am not in them. As I said, the description of Nirguna Ishvara Swarupam is what we are going to learn from verses 9.4 to 9.10, which is the essence or saram of all the Upanishads. Here, Lord Krishna enlightens to us about the higher nature of the God. Three descriptions of Nirguna Ishvara Swarupam are given in this verse. The first one is Avyakta Murtihi Ishvaraha. God in his higher nature is attributeless, nirguna, and formless. The second one is Nirguna Ishvara Sarvagataha. And the third one is Jagat Adhishtanam. Now moving on to the first description, which is Avyakta Murtihi Ishvaraha. Here the word Avyakta means Anindriya Gochara, that is, not perceptible to any sense organs. We all know we have 5 sense organs: the eyes, the ears, the nose, the tongue, and the skin. So basically, each one of this object has got the property of each guna. For example, the tongue has the rasa guna, the ear has the shabda guna, the eye, we can perceive the rupa guna, the nose, we can perceive the smell, the gandha guna, and the skin, we can perceive the sparsha, that is the touch. But in case of the higher nature of the God, we cannot perceive any of these. That is a shabda, a rupa, a gandha, a sparsha, and a rasa. So, since he does not have any of these gunas, we call him nirguna. And also the word murtihi means he is formless and he has no boundaries. If Lord is free from all attributes, what does it mean to us? It means if you have experienced God in a particular form, then it is the lower nature of God. In Vedantic angle, it is not the real one. The higher God is not an object of experience, as it is free from all attributes. Now, let's move on to the second description of God, the higher nature of God, which is Nirguna Ishvaraha Sarvagataha. Here, the word Sarvagataha, what does it mean? It means God is all-pervading, God is present everywhere, there is no spatial limitation. The word Tatam means Sarvagatam. You need not go in search of God or travel to any of the lokas to find him. Lord is here and now. In Vedanta, merger is the wisdom that the Lord is never away. He is in every one of us. Dropping the notion of division is merger. Moving to the third property of the higher nature of God, which is extremely important. It is Jagat Adhishtanam. As the word describes, the Lord is the supporter of the universe. Here Lord Krishna says, the whole universe or the whole world is resting in me. I am the supporter of the universe, always the supporter, but never the supported. When we go to the English translation of the verse, we heard Lord Krishna quoting that, all beings are in me, still I'm not in them. It's very important we understand this aspect here. To better understand this, I would like to quote an example. And this example, we will consider waves located in water. I have a picture which explains this, and I would like you to sort of concentrate or observe this picture keenly for the next few seconds. We have waves located in water. Therefore, the wave is supported by water. What should we understand by this? We understand two principles. The first principle, that there is no wave which is separate from the water. The second principle is, when we say that the wave is or the wave exists, the existence does not belong to the wave. It is a borrowed feature from the water. How do we prove that? If we remove the water, the wave cannot exist independently. In a similar way, Lord Krishna says, all beings need me for their existence, but I can exist without them. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Rupa, for a very clear attempt to try to resolve this contradiction of these difficult verses that Sri Krishna has given. That is why I said, to be able to understand these verses, we need a little experience of the Upanishads, and then it becomes unbelievable to see that the real divine is not somewhere far away. It is here, and it is here in me as the experiencer. And what all these attributes that you're speaking about is not of any other principle, but of the higher consciousness within me. Why do we have so much suffering in spite of all that there is so good in this world? Dr. Ravi Shankar, could you explain this to us?
Yes, sir. Sri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Sri Krishna explains Nirguna Ishwara Jnanam further. He says he is Jagat Karanam. Mamatma is my higher nature. Bhuta Bhavana, I am Srishti Sthiti Karana. And he says this is Satyam. Mami Kam, all forms come unto Prakriti but depend on me. Puna Puna Visrajami, with Prakriti, he creates in a cyclic fashion. Bhuta Grama, multitude of beings are created based on their karma by way of Vashat and Avasham, by force and compulsion. Lord Krishna also says he is asangatva, all pervading like the wind in space. All are in me, but still dvandva atitam, no duality. In spite of all these actions, he is akarta abhokta because he is abhimana varjita. He does all actions with udasina and asakta manah, completely detached with the sakshi bhava. He presides, he supervises and says he is Maya Adhyakshena, but he does not do. Like the light which illumines the act of a criminal and a saint alike, but is not tainted. In the sheer presence, Hetuna, Prakriti, Maya, Apara, they all act in his presence. Having understood this higher nature of Lord, Sri Krishna explains in the next slide. Avajananti ma mudha. Anushim tanu mashritam param bhavam ajananto mama bhuta maheshwaram. Which means, not knowing my higher nature as the great Lord of all beings, those deluded ones look down upon me who have taken a human form. This is very profound. Looking for permanence from the impermanent, wrong expectations, security from the ever insecure, and holding on to the lower form or apara are the deluded called mudaha. Those who think lowly avajananti of the Lord's human form, manushim tanu, not knowing the supreme nature, ajananti param bhavam, are the deluded ones. Para prakriti ajnana eva samsara karana. So not knowing the para prakriti gives rise to samsara. Knowing the Lord in the form of the Lord should be para prakriti, that is the essence. So this is the cause of samsara. Ignorance or ajnana is not a sin. Our teacher says, perpetuating ignorance is a big sin. Puja done with ignorance to a lower form is not upachara, but apachara, says Adi Shankara. Our guru says, don't rely on a cardboard chair which is like a apara prakriti swarupa, limited in desha kala and is in the realms of maya, always changing like asti, jayate, mriyate. They are all finite. But rely on para prakriti, which is nitya brahman, which is attributeless and which is beyond desha and kala. Now Sri Krishna goes to further explain those two types of people. Moghasha mogha karmano mogha jnana vichetasaha. Rakshasi mansurim chaiva prakritim mohinim shrita. There are two types of people. Those who change gods for a finite goal are deluded. Vichetasaha is an aviveki where the sattvic gunas are overpowered. Vimudaha, neither do they know nor do they want to take help and they are intellectually arrogant. Mogha jnanaha, possess fruitless knowledge. Mogha karmani, indulge in futile action which is karma pradhana, ragadvesha pradhana, asuri pradhana. They don't do nitya karmas, they don't do the pancha mahayajna which our teacher always keeps telling us, and that leads to buddhi nashana. Like a little breeze is needed to start a fire, and then the wind and the fire merge to become uncontrollable. kama krodha and buddhi merge into delusion. Now Sri Krishna tells about the other type of people. Mahatmanastu mam partha daivim prakriti mashritaha bhajanti man bhajanti man ananya manaso jnatva bhutadi mabhyaya. Now these type of people are the sattvic people who have a purva janma punya, and they are the great souls, mahatmana. They are the divine nature, daivi prakritim swabhava. They practice panchamahayajna. They are aware of the nitya anitya vastu vivekaha. They are of the nature of pariksha lokan karma chittan. Knowing me, mam jnatva, as the jagat karanam, as the bhutadim, causeless cause, avyayam anadi ananta, with nothing else in their mind, ananya manasa, no distractions, with a vyavasayatmika buddhi, they embrace me with bhakti, ashritaha. Such intelligent people who move from world dependence to God dependence to self dependence, who understand para prakriti as the cause of immortality, who have shraddha and no asuya. Krishna actually calls Arjuna as anasuyu. Understand the solution to this problem of samsara, and this is samsara nivritti. Hari Om, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Ravi Shankar. That was a very clear explanation of the cause of samsara and the parihara, the way to get out of it. Dr. Sundar will now explain about bhakti and the various levels of bhakti. Dr. Sundar, please.
Hari Om, Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. In the Madhyama Shatakam, we see Lord Krishna repeatedly reiterating that the cause of samsara is missing the higher nature of God and being focused upon the lower nature of God. He has also repeatedly told us the solution for this problem is in the form of bhakti culminating in jnanam. In this context, in this chapter, Lord Krishna divides bhakti into three levels. Level 1, Manda Bhakti. Level 2, Madhyama. Level 3, Uttama. Before we go to the verses of this chapter, let us study the three levels of bhakti from various angles or aspects. In this slide, we see that the level 1 or Manda Bhakta worships God as Saguna, Ekarupa Ishvara, Ishta Devata Dhyanam, Lord with one form. Whereas Madhyama Bhakta worships God as Saguna Aneka Vishwarupa Ishvara, or Lord with many forms. Whereas the Uttama Bhakta, through Guru Shastra Upadesha, through Jnana Yoga, is able to worship God as Nirguna Swarupa Ishvara, the formless God. Therefore, we see that there is an evolution in bhakti from one form to many forms to the formless. In the next slide, let us study these three bhaktis in relationship to the creation. For a Manda Bhakta, the definition of God is Nimitta Karana Jagataha. God is the intelligent cause of this creation. He visualizes God as a powerful entity, the creator of this world, situated far away from him in Vaikuntha, Kailasa or Brahmaloka. He visualizes this form of God to appear sometime, disappear other time. A level 2 or Madhyama Bhakta defines God as Nimitta Upadana Karana Jagataha. So he is not just the intelligent creator, he is also the created. Earlier he was seen as the intelligent cause, now he is seen as the material cause of this world as well. By meaning that he is the created, it means that God became this universe, this manifest creation. This brings in sacredness into everything that is there around me. Everything, everywhere I now visualize as God. This form of worship is also called as immanent. God is in and through this creation. Matta parataram na kinchidasti dhananjaya mai sarvam idam protam sutre manigana iva. In both these two forms of bhakti, whether it is created or whether it is the creator, it presupposes a change in form of God, because there is some action happening. And that means that this God is now visualized as one who is having one form and then changes the form as the act of creation happens. This means that there is something beyond that form. In other words, this attributes limitation to this entity called God, whereas scriptures repeatedly state that God is Ananta Swarupam, free of any limitations. Therefore, the Uttama Bhakta comes to realize that God is neither the creator nor the created. Actually, this universe is a false manifestation which is rooted upon God. He visualizes this manifest creation as mithya. He realizes Brahman alone is satyam. He realizes there is a singular homogeneous entity which alone is there, which is also there within him. So he realizes jivatma paravatva aikyam, or jivo brahma iva na para. Let us now study the three levels of bhakti in terms of the type of awareness the bhakta has. So the manda bhakta views God objectively. Although he has not seen God, he has heard or read about this God, who is paroksha kind of knowledge for him. Whereas madhyama bhakta, for whom God is this manifest creation, God is tangible through all his senses at all times, this awareness is pratyaksha jnanam. Whereas for a uttama bhakta, who through knowledge has now resolved this entire manifestation as mithya, for whom there is a singular existence of an entity which is the same as his core self, he visualizes God subjectively with an awareness which is called aparoksha jnanam. Let us now study these three types of bhakti in relation to the bhakta. A level one or mandhya bhakta views God as distinct or separate from him. This is dvaita bhakti. He is a dasa. Whereas a madhyama bhakta, who views everything in creation as God, views himself as a small portion of God. This is vishishta advaita bhakta. And the uttama bhakta, who has resolved this manifest creation and who abides in a singular consciousness of Brahman, whom he sees as his core self, sees God as advaitam, and he sees that Brahman himself and in God as Swami. Now let us view the three levels or types of worship in relation to the mode of bhakti. A manda bhakta views God as a means, an instrument, a sadhana to accomplish various goals in this world. This form of bhakta is usually artha or artharthi. And then some of them realize that there is no everlasting happiness that will come about with this means of life. So they reshuffle their priorities, use all their accomplishments as a means, and go in search of God as a goal, for whom God becomes sadhyam. This form of a bhakta is often a jijnyasu bhakta. And for the uttama type of bhakti, wherein the manifest world is resolved, there is a singular manifestation of Brahman. For him, God is neither the means nor the end. And for such a person is a Siddha Purusha, a Jnani type of Bhakta. Now let us examine the relationship to samsara. A Manda Bhakta is rooted in his body-mind complex. He has intense raga dveshas. He divides the world into favorable and unfavorable. This keeps him bound in samsara. Now here comes the importance of the madhyama level of bhakti, or the Vishwarupa Ishvara bhakti. Lord Krishna is offering this madhyama bhakti or Vishwarupa Ishvara bhakti as a stepping stone to uttama bhakti. Uttama bhakti is worshipping God as being formless, some non-tangible entity, whereas the manda bhakta is used to worshipping God with form. In these verses, chapter 7, chapter 9, we see Lord Krishna asking us to shift over from Ishta Devata Bhakti to Nirguna Swarupa Bhakti. Changing over from a formed God to a formless God is not easy. So therefore, Lord Krishna is offering Vishwarupa Ishwara Bhakti as a stepping stone to make this difficult transition or changeover. We can see when one is rooted in his body-mind complex, one has intense raga-dveshas which binds him to samsara. In Vishwarupa Ishwara Bhakti, when he is able to see everything as a manifestation of God, he is not able to now have raga towards a part of creation and dvesha towards another part of creation because everything is God. Therefore, there is dilution of raga dveshas between mandha and madhyama bhakti. And eventually, in level 3 bhakti, when he has a singular vision of sama atma darshanam, and that atma which is of the form of purnatvam, there is absolutely no scope for any raga or dvesha because one is ever so full, and that wipes out samsara completely. Let us now look at what types of sadhana operate in each levels of worship. Mandha bhakti often is a karmi bhakta. He then uses karma yoga as a sadhana to climb up the ladder, attain chitta shuddhi, become a karma yogi, which is level 2 bhakti. And then after chitta shuddhi, that person uses jnana yoga sadhana as a ladder to climb up to uttama type of bhakti. Let us now go to the verses of this chapter. Jnana yajnena chapanye yajanto mamupasate ekatvena pritaktvena bahudha vishvato mukham. In this verse, Lord Krishna is describing all the three levels which we have studied thus far. Pritaktvena means a worship which is distinct between one form and another form. This is the Ishta Devata Bhakti, which we saw, or level 1 or Manda Bhakti. Then we see Bahudha Vishvato Mukham, that is worshipping this manifest creation in its multitudinous forms as God, which is Vishwarupa Ishwara Bhakti, which we saw. Then he describes Ekatvena. Ekatvam means oneness, Kevalam, Advaitam. So other than God, there is nothing else, which is Brahman or the level 3 or the Uttama form of Bhakti. Further verses describe or ask us to view everything in this universe as the Vishwarupa Ishwara. In those days, there were Shastram, family, rituals, cattle. These were the things associated with the people. So Krishna is asking all these things to be viewed as Vishwarupa Ishwara. Things related to the ritual I am, family I am, Shastram I am, creator, sustainer, destroyer I am the one who maintains universal harmony. So thus Krishna is asking us to make the switch over from Ishta Devata Bhakti to Arupa Ishwara Bhakti by using Vishwarupa Ishwara Bhakti as a stepping stone. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Sundar, for a very brilliant explanation of bhakti, which was available in this chapter. As you showed it in each of this verse, the bhakti comes from your understanding of the nature of God. Initially as pratakvena, as God is separate from me, and then graduate through, as you said, the stepping stone, through Vishvato Mukha, to be able to see every form as God, and finally to the most difficult one, Ekatvena. Krishna also gives some very beautiful words like Patram, Pushpam, Palam, Toyam. It does not need that any special offering that you need to do. Whatever you have, you offer. But how do you offer? With the bhava of bhakti. If you don't have any of these, it does not matter. Whatever you do, whatever you consume, yad karoshi, yad asnasi, yad duhoshi, dadati, yad. You know, if you offer it in the whatever your daily actions which you do, do it in the form of bhakti. And that is the advice of Sri Krishna in this chapter. Now, Rama will explain to us about Sakama and Nishkama Bhaktas. Rama, please.
श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ओम विवेक चूड़ामणि सेज भक्ति इज द सुप्रीम मीन्स फॉर मोक्ष एंड भक्ति इज स्वस्वरूपानुसंधानम मीनिंग ए कांस्टेंट कॉन्टेम्प्लेशन ऑफ वन्स रियल नेचर ए पर्सन हैविंग भक्ति इज ए भक्ता भक्ति विच इज कॉमन इन कर्मयोग उपासन योग एंड ज्ञान योग इज ऑफ टू टाइप्स सकामा एंड निष्कामा लीडिंग टू अद्वैत भक्ति People trapped in Sakama Bhakti are ignorant of the superior Nishkama Bhakti and are known as Kama Kamaha. They have a desire for Anatma Vishayas and exchange Punyam for enjoyment in the Anitya Swarga. They will come back to earth on zero Punyam balance. These Sakama Bhaktas will never get moksha or independence from samsara because they are caught up in an endless cycle of Punyam and pleasures. God is only the means and world is the end for Sakama Bhaktas, whereas God is both for Nishkama Bhaktas. For Bhakti to fructify into Moksha, the important condition is for Sakama Bhakti to become Nishkama Bhakti, eventually leads to Advaita Bhakti. Nishkama Bhakti can be developed by acquiring Viveka and Vairagya. Viveka is the knowledge of Nitya, Anitya Vastu, And Vairagyam is to transcend raga towards life and desha towards death. In the chapter 7 and the 16th verse, Bhagavan classifies the bhaktas as artha bhakta, artharthi bhakta, jignasu bhakta, and jnani bhakta. Artha and artharthi bhaktas are sakama bhaktas, whereas jignasu and jnani are nishkama bhaktas. This Jignasu Bhakta is again of three types, Gruhastha, Vividisha Sanyasi, and Vidvat Sanyasi. For both Gruhastha and Vividisha Sanyasi, Moksha is a distant goal and Bhagavan is Sadhyam. They have interest in Atma Jnanam and they have Dvaita Bhakti. Vidvat Sanyasi. Ananya Bhaktas who are Parivrajakas, they have completed Shravanam and Mananam, they have dedicated to Nididhyasanam and have Jnana Nishta. They own nothing and are nomads. They are content with what they get because they are Bhagavat Sharanaha. They see Bhagavan as Siddha Rupam and not as Sadhya Rupam. With this background, we will see the summary of this verse. अनन्याश चिंतयन्तो माम ये जनाः पर्युपासते तेषां नित्याभियुक्तानां योगक्षेमं वहाम्यहम् Whoever contemplates me with undivided attention unifies their mind with me and I will take care of their योगक्षेमं Word meaning ये जनाः those are अनन्याः माम अद्वैत भक्तास who see me as non-different from them Chintayantaha contemplates Jagatkarana Brahman as themselves, Nityabhiyuktanam constantly practices Advaita Bhakti through all actions, Paryupasate, offer worship through meditation. Tesham, for such the Advaita Bhaktas, Yogakshemam Aham Vahami. I take responsibility and provide the bare necessities. Yoga is fulfilling bare necessities. Kshemam is nurturing what has been granted. He gives two reasons for this in the 7th chapter saying, Jnani tu atmaiva matam. I am Jnani and Jnani is myself. I have to take care of myself. And the second reason is, Sacha me priyaha. The dear I reserve for them only. Jnanis are Sarva Sangha Parityagis, therefore Bhagavan feels responsible for them and has taken a vow that he will protect those people who surrender to him. From the verse, there are three essential requirements to be a Nishkama Bhakta. Ananyas Chintayantaha. In the next slide, we can see this. Ananyas Chintayantaha, single-pointed devotion. Paryupasate, the worship of the highest, the Supreme Lord alone, Nityabhiyuktanam, always self-controlled and steadfast. With this, Bhagavan grants Yogakshemam. For such bhaktas, The Lord promises to take care of their needs like a baby being nourished in the mother's womb because of the state of non-separation. However, the non-separation status continues with Ananya Bhaktaha. Hari Om. Thank you.
Thank you, Ramaji, for a very nice explanation. We come to the concluding verse, the 34th verse on the glory of the bhakti, and that will be explained to us by Vindhya. Vindhya is a student of Christ University studying psychology and literature. At a very young age, she has written 5 books and has been a student of Vedanta from the age of 14. Vindhya, please.
Manmana bhava madhakto madhyaji mam namaskuru mame vaishasi yuktvevam atmanam matparayanaha. Here's the English translation. Fix the mind on me. Be my devotee. Keep me as the supreme goal. Be my worshipper. Surrender to me. Fixing the mind in this manner, you will reach me alone, who am the self. Mam or me refers to God, who will help us realize our higher self in this spiritual journey. Let's go to the next slide. Glory of Bhakti. This verse talks about the lifestyle of a bhakta. In our spiritual journey, we go through a gradual transition towards realization of our higher self. In this process, all our daily actions also go through this transition. Thus, our behavior needs to be refined to realize Parabrahma. There are 5 factors that Swamiji mentions about the activities of a bhakta. It is easy to learn them as gradual steps that we should progress towards one after another. This pyramid shows a decreasing order of our goals as we go up, because at the top of the pyramid, we realize God is our only goal. First is Madhbhakta Bhava. Develop devotion towards God. Learning to love God is the most important aspect in the spiritual journey. At this stage, most of us love God as a means to attain worldly pleasures. God is not the end goal here. We pray God for attaining good health, money, good relationships, and these are all temporary goals, and it is in multitude. Hence, it comes at the base of the pyramid. Next is Matparayanaha Bhava. At this stage, you realize that worldly goals have limitations. We look for PHS, peace, happiness, and security, but you begin to realize that it is only temporary. Your secure relationships can give you sadness, or money kept in a bank is safe only until there is some uncertainty like a pandemic. Spiritual courses like this help us understand and realize that the material world gives us temporary PHS. At this stage, after realization, we should consciously make God as our ultimate goal. Realization of God helps attain moksha, which is eternal PHS, peace, security, happiness. The third stage is Manmana Bhava. At this stage, you should ensure not to lose sight of God as the goal. At the same time, we must continue to do our vyavaharik or worldly activities, but remember, God is our destination. For example, when an athlete has a goal of winning the Olympics, what they eat, how they exercise, when they sleep, all these activities are done with keeping in mind the end goal of winning the medal. Our goal to realize God should be like this. Madhyaji Bhava is the 4th stage. Upon realizing that God is our ultimate goal, all our actions must be converted into worship of the Lord. For example, while eating food, remember God and acknowledge it as a gift from God. Convert all your actions into spiritual sadhanas. Slowly, we begin to perform our daily mundane actions seamlessly. The final stage is Mam Namaskuru. By the time we reach this stage, we would have already progressed spiritually because we have learned to love God, to consider God as our ultimate goal, and all our actions are performed in praise of the Lord. What is important at this stage is to be aware of our progress, but remain humble. Realize that whatever good is happening in our lives is because of the grace of the Lord. Therefore, in understanding the strength of the Almighty, surrender to the Lord and follow all the spiritual sadhanas. Thus, Mam Namaskuru indicates the importance of grace. In summary, you must start with devotion to attain moksha. With the guidance of a guru and spiritual classes, this devotion can transcend from Madhbhakta Bhava to Mam Namaskuru. This ends the 9th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Hari Om.
Thank you very much, Vindhya, for a brilliant explanation of the most important concluding advice by Sri Krishna in this chapter of how to be a Param Bhakta, the highest form of Bhakta. Sri Krishna will repeat the same mantra again in the 18th chapter, 63rd verse, then you know the importance of this particular mantra. With this, we come to the end of a very beautiful 9th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. I will give you a little glimpse of the 10th chapter, which we are going to study the next week. The 10th chapter is called the Vibhuti Yoga. In all these chapters in the Madhyama Shatkam, our main objective is to be able to know God. Initially, God is seen as a creator. Now, because there is a beautiful creation, I infer there must be a creator. And because I do not see him around, I have to infer. Because the creation is so wonderful, I think it must be a human being, but not an ordinary human being, somebody superhuman, but far away. That's why I call remote. And I always feel that if I get to see that Lord, my life is going to be fulfilled. But what is that right form that I do not know? That is why we need scriptures and God to help us to find out which is the right form of God. And if I know, it is like having a GPS. If I know, if I have a sense of direction, then I'm able to work in that particular direction. These particular, from the 7th onwards, Krishna is giving us a stepping stone to move from Ekarupa to Arupa. The big question that we need to answer is, if in the beginning only God existed and nothing else existed, with what did God create? God had to create from himself, which means whatever I see is nothing other than a form of God, a lower form of God, but God itself. And if I realize that the ground and the sun and the moon and all the beings around me are nothing but God, then my sense of reverence to the world, my likes and dislikes all disappear. And based on this question, we have the 10th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, which is a preclude to Vishwarupa Ishwara Darshan. If I'm able to appreciate the glories of the creation, then I'm able to see the glory of the Creator. This chapter came about because Arjuna asks Sri Krishna, this universe is so vast for me to be able to focus on, to be able to meditate on. Can you give me a few symbols for me to focus on? For example, the country India is very big. Now, if I have a flag of the country, then I'm able to relate to. And that is how this whole chapter, Vibhuti Yoga. For example, if you see Ashwatha tree and Krishna says, I am in that tree. So whenever you see a tree, and particularly the Ashwatha tree, you're able to relate to it. And that is what we were going to see the next week. We'll conclude today's class by listening to the chanting of this beautiful 20 verses of the 9th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Meenakshi, please. Meenakshi and Shyamala, go ahead.
Hari Om. अथ नवमोऽध्यायः राजविद्या राजगुह्ययोगः श्रीभगवानुवाच इदं तु ते गुह्यतमं प्रवक्ष्याम्यनसूयवे ज्ञानं विज्ञानसहितं यज्ञात्वा मोक्ष्यसे शुभात् राजविद्या राजगुह्यं पवित्रमिदमुत्तमं प्रत्यक्षावगमं धर्म्यं सुसुखं कर्तुमव्ययम् अश्रद्धधाना पुरुषाः धर्मस्यास्य परन्तप अप्राप्य माम् निवर्तन्ते मृत्यु संसारवर्त्मनि
मया ततमिदं सर्वं जगदव्यक्तमूर्तिना मत्स्थानि सर्वभूतानि न चाहं तेष्वस्थितः
न च मत्स्थानि भूतानि पश्य मे योगमैश्वरम् भूतभृन्न च भूतस्थः ममात्मा भूतभावनः
यथा काशस्थितो नित्यं वायुः सर्वत्र गोमहान् तथा सर्वाणि भूतानि मत्स्थानीत्युपधारय
सर्वभूतानि कौन्तेय प्रकृतिं यान्ति मामिकां कल्पक्षये पुनस्तानि कल्पादौ विसृजाम्यहम्
प्रकृतिं स्वामवष्टभ्य विसृजामि पुनः पुनः भूतग्राममिमं कृत्स्नम् अवशं प्रकृतेर्वशात्
न च मां तानि कर्माणि निबध्नन्ति धनञ्जय उदासीनवदासीनम् असक्तं तेषु कर्मसु
मयाध्यक्षेण प्रकृतिः सूयते सचराचरम् हेतुनानेन कौन्तेय जगद्विपरिवर्तते
अवजानन्ति मां मूढाः मानुषीं तनुमाश्रितम् परं भावमजानन्तः मम भूतमहेश्वरम्
मोघाशामोघकर्माणः मोघज्ञानाविचेतसः राक्षसी मासुरीं चैव प्रकृतिं मोहिनीं श्रिताः
महात्मानस्तु मां पार्थ दैवीं प्रकृतिमाश्रिताः भजन्त्यनन्यमनसः ज्ञात्वा भूतादिमव्ययम्
सततं कीर्तयन्तो मां यतन्तश्च दृढव्रताः नमस्यन्तश्च मां भक्त्या नित्ययुक्ता उपासते
ज्ञानयज्ञेन चाप्यन्ये यजन्तो मामुपासते एकत्वेन पृथक्त्वेन बहुधा विश्वतो मुखम्
अहं क्रतुरहं यज्ञः स्वधाहामहमौषधम् मन्त्रोऽहमहमेवाज्यम् अहमग्निरहं हुतम्
पिताहमस्य जगतः माता धाता पितामहः वेद्यं पवित्रमोङ्कारः रुक्सामयजुरेव च
गतिर्भर्ता प्रभुः साक्षी निवासः शरणं सुहृत प्रभव प्रलयस्थानं निधानं बीजमव्ययम्
तपाम्यहमहं वर्षं निगृह्णाम्युत्सृजामि च अमृतं चैव मृत्युश्च सदसच्चाहमर्जुन
त्रैविद्या मां सोमपूतपापाः यज्ञैरिष्ट्वा स्वर्गतिं प्रार्थयन्ते ते पुण्यमासाद्य सुरेन्द्रलोकम् अश्नन्ति दिव्यान् दिवि देवभोगान्
हरि ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरि ॐ
Thank you, Shyamala and Meenakshi. Friends, we have arrived at the end of today's class. Thank you very much for your patient listening. Next week, we are going to visit Vibhuti of Bhagavan in 10th chapter named Vibhuti Yoga. Video recording of this class and study material will reach you soon. We shall meet next Friday, same time. Please log in before 6:45 p.m. local time. Namaste. Now, let's conclude the class with Shanti Mantra. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om.